Hi guys, so welcome to the Chit Chat Show with me, and I've got Francesco from Italy. I've got Daniele Canepa, who is a new father, just had a baby, and I've got the great and the indefatigable Omar Akatsuba, one that is a role model for a lot of people. But let's focus on what we've got today. We've got just like 30 minutes or so to run through this. Francesco, can you introduce yourself to us?
Se ti puoi presentare, Francesco.
Sì, io sono un blogger e ho creato a Genova, assieme ad altri amici, un blog che si chiama Pagina 200, dal vecchio indice del televideo. Se vuoi tradurre.
Ok, so thank you. My name is Francesco, and together with some friends in Genoa, some other bloggers like me, I have created a blog about sports. The name in Italian is Pagina 200. It means page 200, and that's named after the teletext page in Italian. It was about sports. It was page 200.
All right. Let me go to Omar so that Omar introduce himself to everybody. Omar, can you introduce yourself, and Daniele would also start it.
Okay, hello everyone. My name is Omar Akatsuba. First, I'm a sports journalist, but I've morphed into the CEO of Omar Sports Group. Omar Sports Group owns omarsports.com, the website, Omar Sports TV, our YouTube platform, our digital TV channel, and of course, Tenno Sports, which is our kit manufacturing business. And of course, we are into the management of athletes in terms of promotion, PR, and management of the career of young athletes. And of course, you know, well-known athletes as the opportunities present themselves. So that is me.
All right, guys. Daniele, I hope you can translate that to Francesco, or does he understand?
Yes, si è presentato ma dicendo che appunto hai capito già comunque fra più o meno. Che ha un... Sì, ok. Yeah, he's understood the gist, yes.
Okay, so...
Tutto bene, come estas?
Okay, Daniele, can you introduce yourself to us, even though you're not showing us your face?
Yes. Yeah, sorry for not showing my face, but I have problems with my connection tonight. Anyway, I'm Daniele Canepa. I'm a teacher. I am also a writer, and I'm currently writing a book about football trafficking. I've written articles for the blog of my friend Francesco, and I've, you know, I'm a friend, and we've worked together with Matthew. We've done some projects together, so I'm very happy to be here.
Okay, so first question that I'm going to throw to you, Francesco, is in this COVID-19 period, how have you been able to cope as a blogger to gather factual information, news, and to put it out there? Because now you have to check and double check and triple check and quadruple check. How have you been able to gather stories?
Quindi la domanda fra è come sei riuscito in questo periodo di COVID-19, diciamo, a prendere, a ricavare informazioni, perché ovviamente è difficile e servono anche diversi check alle informazioni che si ricavano.
Personalmente ho dovuto rivoluzionare tutta la modalità con cui ho assunto informazioni in questi ultimi 3 mesi. Ho dovuto, quelle che erano le mie testate di riferimento italiane, le ho dovute abbandonare a favore di altre che ho ritenuto più veritiere.
Ok, so I've had to revolutionize the way that I collect information. For example, I've had to abandon the sources for information that I used to have in Italy, and follow other ones which have turned out to be more truthful.
Ho dovuto cercare delle testate che volessero fare veramente informazione, e questo significava non solamente utilizzare dei titoloni per fare un click, ma per dare delle informazioni che responsabilizzassero la popolazione di fronte alla difficoltà che c'era, senza impaurirla troppo, ma dandogli degli giusti strumenti per capire.
So I've had to look for websites and newspapers that were not interested in you know, doing any clickbaiting activities, but rather I had to look for websites and sources of information that aim to inform people, not to make them feel terrified or scared.
E questo per quanto riguarda l'informazione mainstream, ovviamente. E ho completato poi la mia modalità di informarmi tramite delle testate più secondarie, meno conosciute, ma che puntavano molto sull'aspetto sociale e di welfare di questo evento collettivo.
So I've had to look for sources of information that were more focusing more on the social side, on the welfare side of this event that has been going on.
Okay, so let me switch to Omar. Omar, your business, your way of getting stories, you cover a lot of African players that are in Europe, and it involved you traveling to almost everywhere. And I was telling Daniele that the next time you're going to go visit Italy and you go to the city of Genoa, it should give you a bottle of wine on my behalf for doing a good job in Europe. So have you been able to deal with the fact that you can't travel anymore, there is limitation of movement, but then I still see you put out stories every day. You just put out a very interesting story about, what's the name of this player now? That's playing?
Williams Echo.
You talked about Tristan Kong, the conversation you had with him, and then there was the player that plays for Nigeria at youth level that plays for Haiti.
Yeah, Emmanuel Saki.
Yeah, so have you been able to go through all of that?
Well, first thing first, it must be said that I can see that from the look on our faces, it's not good times at all.
I'm sure. Not at all.
You see, the pandemic basically has affected the entire world. Businesses have been shut down. And of course, the media hasn't been spread. A lot of media organizations have closed up. A lot of journalists have been laid off. Many journalists are going through difficult times, having even mental issues, because nobody was told that there was a pandemic that was going to shut down the world suddenly, and nobody prepared for it mentally, economically, spiritually, and psychologically. And this came and hit us all like a wave, and then changed everything. People are saying that we are trying to get used to the new normal, but I think that it is actually a new abnormal. Because this is not normal. It's going to only get normal after a period of time. That's what normalcy is actually. When something happens for a long period of time and then you get accustomed to it, right?
Yeah.
But we aren't used to this yet. So that's why I call it the new abnormal. So it has immensely affected my work. You just talked about how my work entails physically going to where the action is, right? Because right. That's the way you can basically tell the stories with some level of
authority,
passion, authority and affection, because there's this feeling of community that going to football games brings. You are around the actors, you are seeing the event, you are telling a first-hand experience of what has happened. You are interviewing players, you are looking into their eyes, because you have eye contact with your interviewee. That way you can be able to, you know, picture what they are about to say and exactly understand what they mean by what they say. Because sometimes what people say is different from what they mean. But when you are in close contact with these people, you are able to tell the stories in ways that your readers assimilate and then congest or consume in a more interesting manner. But all of that has been basically taken away. as a result of the restrictions on travel, the ban on public gatherings, and what have you. But hey, they say, okay.
No, go ahead. No, finish that thought before I ask Daniel.
Okay, in life, when situations hit you, you have to adjust to these situations and find ways of doing things. So we are basically taking advantage of digital media to get our lives going, even though it can't be as things used to be. Because they say that when the preferred is not available, the available becomes the preferred. So we have taken advantage of digital media to still be able to put out stories as journalists. But I think that community feeling that we had as journalists before now, and of course, the entertainment value of sitting inside a large, big stadium with a 60,000 capacity crowd, watching Ronaldo play physically, you are able to tell the story more than just watching him on television. And his interesting part is that football has returned, but we are still on lockdown. So that makes it all the more difficult, mentally, spiritually, and professionally.
I'm going to bring something about Cristiano Ronaldo later. Maybe everybody should think about it. Ronaldo now, for the very first time, have lost two cup finals back to back. Maurizio Sarri coached Napoli for about 6 years, if I'm not mistaken, did not win anything. It's taken 111 days for General Gattuso, the beast, the animal of AC Milan, to come in and win against Maurizio Sarri with Cristiano Ronaldo and Juventus. This is a new abnormal that we're getting used to with Cristiano Ronaldo and with Juventus. Yeah. But having said that, before we deal with that, Daniele, you just had a baby. And I have a baby that's going to be 1 year next month on the 13th. And I know how it is. What is fatherhood like in this pandemic era? What is fatherhood like? You have your wife, yourself in the home. You are afraid of the visitors that are coming because you don't know what they are bringing. The baby is very vulnerable. The wife is very vulnerable. A whole lot is going on. How have you been able to deal with that and not jeopardize the balance of family and extended family?
This is a good question. I would say, and this latches on to what Francesco was saying about, the reliability of mainstream media. My wife and I don't have a TV. We don't watch TV. Wow. And to be honest, yes, I know that it sounds strange. The information that we look for information on the internet. We, have a look at videos on YouTube. We read articles. To be honest, by doing that, we're kind of more attached to reality. So we managed to keep a better balance than people who I understand that were terrified by watching TV news every day talking about a new apocalypse, which, is not, of course, I mean, I'm not saying that there hasn't been a pandemic, there has been, but, the fact that we are very, very much rooted in reality helped us, get over it quite well. And for me, from a certain point of view, obviously the pandemic was not a good thing. I've also lost a lot of work, but, I think in every situation, there's an opportunity. For me, this was an opportunity to be closer to my wife, be close to my child as he's growing up, to study, go back to reading, I thought, okay, now I've got time because I'm not working much, okay, making less money, all right, but okay, so what can I do? And I've started writing a book, as I was saying, I've kept doing my work with Mission 89. So I think in every situation there's an opportunity. It depends on how you use it. But I want to, agree and stress what Francesco was saying about the fact that I think probably, let's call them secondary media, they're not really secondary, because probably they're more free to describe what reality is like. And by following those media, you have a better depiction of reality.
Thank you. Now, I'm going to take this question before we come to the Ronaldo, Sarri and Gattuso matter. I'm going to take this to Francesco. Every businessman is a capitalist. You put money, small money to make big money. Whether you're going to do charity, whether you're going to love people, the environment, you're going to be an activist, you want to make money. How has pandemic affected your money, Francesco? How has this pandemic affected your money?
Hai capito, Fra?
Come ha toccato i miei soldi fondamentalmente, giusto?
E diceva praticamente per ogni comunque persona che diciamo si occupa in qualche ha un qualche tipo di attività, ovviamente questa attività è per generare comunque un guadagno o riuscirci a campare. E quindi, per esempio, nel caso della tua attività, questa pandemia com'è che ha influenzato la tua attività?
Ok. Una cosa rispetto alla precedente domanda, volevo dire, io ho tolto Facebook dal mio smartphone e ho cercato di non informarmi tramite Facebook e ho recuperato ad esempio Twitter. Ci tenevo a dirlo perché sulle modalità di informazione ritengo che Facebook abbia delle grossissime lacune.
Ok. So just to complete the answer to the question before, Francesco wanted to add that he removed Facebook from his smartphone and, for example, he started using Twitter more. This is because he thinks that Facebook, has some fallacies when it comes to information. Yeah. Okay, so this was completely the answer.
That's true.
Rispondo alla domanda dicendo che il Covid e la pandemia ha portato un crollo drastico della pubblicità, nel senso che nessuno aveva più necessità di comunicare, nessuno aveva più necessità di far conoscere il proprio prodotto, perché tutti eravamo atomizzati nelle nostre case.
Okay, so COVID-19 and the pandemic, what they've generated is a collapse in advertising. There was no need to advertise because people basically were at home and, you know, they were just focused on being at home and focused on the pandemic.
Io lavoro in un web magazine qua a Genova che vive di piccola, grande e media pubblicità e è stato una tragedia perché ogni parte della nostra realtà è crollata. E io che lavoro più a contatto con la parte dei teatri ho quasi perso il lavoro, ecco, fondamentalmente.
Yes, he said that he almost lost his job because he works with a web advertising agency and especially he works with theaters and obviously with the interruption of theater performances, you know, all that all the advertising, big or small, that was linked to that industry, linked to that sector, collapsed. So he almost lost his job.
E concludo dicendo che per dare un'idea di come il mercato della pubblicità sia crollato, persino Google non dava più delle retrocessioni sugli ADV, perché non c'era più nessuno che spendeva su Google e quindi di conseguenza gli ADV all'interno dei siti non rendevano più nulla e quindi non esisteva più nessun tipo di pubblicità.
And he wants to complete this answer by saying that the market for advertising collapsed to a point that not even Google was paying anymore for the ads inside websites because people were just, you know, they couldn't care, they were just not interested.
Yeah, so Omar, we had a conversation yesterday and it related to what you just said. So this seems to like shed more light to that numbers thing that we were talking about yesterday. But having said that,
that's why I'm nodding my head.
Yes, even me, because I'm affected too. So football is back, but football is back without the real actors of the game, the people that breathe life into the game, the people that put support, put their money, put their passion and investment, which is the fans. It seems to have gone well in Germany. In terms of how they arranged the game, and also Spain, the Spanish guys have gotten it right. Germany have gotten it right. Italy was still waiting because it's only the cup game that they played. One match day in England, and everything is disastrous. A goal was scored by Sheffield United. It wasn't allowed. Arsenal, the most calamitous defending by a World Cup defender in the mood of David Luiz, everything collapsed. In the midst of that, Omar, can you make sense of it? Because while we're talking about this, Bayern are champions of Germany already, 8 times in a row. Italy was still struggling. But can you make sense of all of these that have happened? What has happened in Spain? Messi cannot stop breaking and setting new records. 20 plus goals in 12 seasons. That is incredible. I don't know. Yeah. Can you make sense of all of this from your own perspective?
Well, I think that it's even still weird that football is back. I'm still trying to get used to the fact that people are playing football. You know, because like Daniel is, said that people are just at home and are more interested in being at home and staying healthy. Just surviving and not contracting, the deadly coronavirus. People are not really thinking of entertainment at this point in time. So when I see footballers playing in an empty stadium, it still doesn't feel like football. It still feels to me like a group of guys just kicking at the park. You understand? So it's difficult to make sense, actually. But we can actually say that people like Messi seems, not to have lost any kind of form. You know, we've seen him at home several times, having a kickabout with his dog. Looks like that has helped him to stay fit, even though everyone was on lockdown. Germany, basically was the bellwether in the whole plan to restart football. And of course, every other league looked up to Germany. Germany did a beautiful job, had a fantastic presentation, convinced the German government, and they were allowed to return. They did all of the COVID-19 preparation, setting up a COVID-19 committee, testing everyone, buying test kits worth 2.3 million euros. Other leagues, borrowed this blueprint and then agitated to return. And of course, as we speak, only Italy is waiting to return, apart from France, who completely cancelled, which I think was a hasty decision. That's a matter for another day. So I think it's interesting that football is back again and we're able to see, some of the best players do what they know how to do best. Arsenal, not a surprise. It's like same of the same. They continue from where they left off. Arsenal is a progressive calamity. It progressively, deteriorates.
You're insulting us, right? Good.
That's a difficult stretch you're putting on right now. So it's generally still weird. But I think as time goes on, we'll get used to it. I'll be able to make proper sense of what is going on right now.
Okay, before I come to my Italian, so that he explained to me, almost this ended in disaster with Carlo Ancelotti in charge. Let's not forget that Napoli were almost dead and buried, almost going to pull out of the league. They were in all sorts of... In short, Napoli had their own pandemic before any other person saw pandemic. Napoli started their own football pandemic. But somehow, General Gattuso have been able to turn the team around. Dries Mertens is the record goal scorer for Napoli. Everybody seems to be heading in the same direction. At the beginning, they said that Gattuso is not a good coach. He's just, crazy guy. But Daniele and Francesco, how have Gattuso been able to manage the situation at the oldest stadium in Europe, at the Naples Stadium, and turn things around so well that Napoli are the champions, the Italian Cup, or Cup the Italian champion? Hello, Daniele. Daniel, can you hear me?
He said, Matthew, he said he couldn't hear you. He wrote a message.
Okay. Okay, so can I, let me come back again. Can you hear me now? Okay. Can you hear me now? Omar, are you hearing me?
Yes, of course. I can hear you loud and clear.
Okay, so it's not from my end then. I don't know if Daniel is hearing me, but I want to believe that he should. Everything is supposed to be very clear to everyone, but I don't know. Maybe he's gone. He's logged out and logged in again. I wanted him to help me make sense. But while he's not here, Omar, let me ask you this: Bayern are champions again. At some point, it's good for me because they got trophy in Nigeria once again next season. Okay, so works well for somebody like me, you know. But I want to know. At some point, RB Leipzig looked like the team that was going to win the title. Now they did not win it. They are selling every player. Timo Werner is gone. A few other of the players are going. Is RB Leipzig becoming the Tottenham Hotspur of German Bundesliga, or they are replacing Borussia Dortmund as the groom and sell club of the German Bundesliga?
I mean, it's not a surprise what is happening at RB Leipzig. RB Leipzig is actually like a conduit pipe. It's the elder sister of this club in Austria. Was Red Bull Salzburg?
Red Bull Salzburg, yeah.
Yeah. But because of the regulations in Germany where a club can't be, you know, backed by corporate organization. I mean, a club can be backed, but a club cannot be, the name of a club cannot be owned, God bless you, by a brand. That's why you have Rasenball Sport, Leipzig. But under the carpet, it is still Red Bull Leipzig. You know, so I think that for a club like Leipzig, the model would be to get players mostly from Austria, move them to Germany, and then move them outside to other leagues in Europe within, you know, to invest on them. So it's not a surprise. And that is why, you know, most times this kind of clubs cannot favorably compete against a team like Bayern, who are the financial, you know, juggernaut of German football and one of the biggest and commercially viable teams in the whole of Europe. So RB Leipzig been for me, pretenders, actually. They've shown a bit of flash that they could or they can compete at the very top with Bayern and Borussia Dortmund. But it looks like they don't have true character. Just like you said, just like Tottenham in England, you know, they're neither here nor there, which is why you can't really put your money on them, especially with their model. When they get the best players, the players shine, they move away. Look at Naby Keita. Naby Keita was also one of the products of RB Leipzig, but now he's in Liverpool. Now we've seen Timo Werner is gone. There's also this defender, what's his name, the Akamu Kancho, or whatever his name is.
Yeah.
He's also
Upamecano,
fine. He's also been touted to leave RB Leipzig as soon as possible. So with such a model, it will be difficult to achieve a level of consistency and be able to compete against a team as huge, as powerful, as domineering as Bayern. Bayern is not just a big team in Germany. It's a big team in the whole of Europe. They are looking like the favorite to even win the Champions League this season. So how much more a Bundesliga where teams aren't so financially strong as them? So it's not a surprise.
Okay, we have less than 5 minutes to end it, and I'm going to end with Daniele. Daniele is back. Daniele and Francesco, can you please explain to me what's the magic behind Gennaro Gattuso transforming a dead and near buried Napoli with so much crisis, with their own pandemic before pandemic? Now they are the champions of Italy against the old lady, the Zebras, Juventus, the strongest team in Italy. What happened? What did Gennaro Gattuso do in 111 days that turned them into an FA, a cup champion ahead of Juventus?
Yeah, the fear di Gattuso che mi ha fatto a rivoluzionare
il Napoli. Gattuso tecnicamente non credo sia un allenatore particolarmente rivoluzionario, però così come da giocatore è stato un grande giocatore di sostanza, allo stesso modo lo è anche come allenatore.
So Gattuso, in Francesco's opinion, is not a revolutionary from the technical and tactical point of view, but just like he was as a player, you know, he's a player of substance, you know.
Gattuso ha una grande capacità, ha una grande qualità, che è l'umiltà. Gattuso, quando aveva 14-15 anni, Gattuso viene dalla Calabria, che è, insomma, è una delle regioni più povere d'Italia. Gattuso da ragazzo a 14 anni ha preso e è andato a vivere, a giocare in Scozia e si è fatto le ossa in Scozia. E questo, diciamo, lo ha forgiato come uomo e come calciatore.
So an important aspect about Gattuso is that he comes from a very poor region, probably the poorest region in Italy, and so he's a very humble, unassuming man. And when he was very young, he had to move to Scotland to pay his dues as a footballer. So this has helped him a lot.
E questa sua grande umiltà è ciò che gli permette, e vengo alla sua domanda, di creare un ambiente all'interno dello spogliatoio che tantissimi altri non hanno la capacità di fare, nel senso che è un grande motivatore, è una persona che è onesta e ha magari anche dei modi un po' rudi, ma spicci, ma che possono, insomma, in un campo di calcio possono essere ottimali, ecco.
And this humility is the very quality that allows him to have a certain influence in the dressing room, which other coaches might not have, but he has it because he's very straightforward. Sometimes he could be blunt, but you know, this straightforwardness is, you know, a fantastic quality.
Il segreto di Gattuso è che è l'umanità, secondo me, è quello di essere una persona molto umana, e nella partita di ieri diciamo, è riuscito anche a mettere un po', diciamo, di romanzo, no? Perché in questi ultimi 20 giorni Gattuso ha perso la sorella, che è morta una decina di giorni fa, e quindi diciamo che anche questo evento ha rafforzato un po', come dire, lo spogliatoio attorno al proprio allenatore.
Okay, and probably a personal tragedy that he's recently had, he lost his sister about 10 days ago, this probably even strengthened the bond between the coach and the players. So this probably has helped to cement the unity of the dressing room in the Napoli dressing room.
Was that death related to coronavirus, COVID-19?
Era una morte per COVID?
No, aveva dei problemi pregressi.
No, not at all. She already had diabetes problems.
Okay.
So unrelated to COVID.
Condolences to Gattuso and the Gattuso family.
That's vital information.
Yeah, very, very vital. At this point, I wish we had a lot more time. We are out of time. And thank you very much, Daniele, I have to take you away from the responsibility of taking care of your, I think, about 3 weeks or 4 weeks old baby now. And thank you very much, Francesco, for sharing your thoughts with us. But this is not the final one. We're still going to have to talk again and again. And Omar, I know you're a very busy man. You're also a father of two lovely kids, like I am a father of three. And I know how that can be sometimes. I have to lock the doors to this room to be able to do this. Thank you, everybody, for sharing your thoughts. But it's something that we would always do intermittently. We are all in the same business, facing the same challenges, and we hope that you would also be able to shine the light so that other people will have hope and believe that they can, you know, survive this And when we come out of it, we would appreciate the freedom, the greater freedom we used to have that we took for granted. Thank you very much, Daniele. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Omar.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure.
Okay, what happened to my hair? I wanted to do a brand adjustment to my person. So if you look at my Facebook, you've started seeing the pictures coming out and on Instagram.
Yes.
So I wanted to let people understand that I've transitioned from being that guy who make noise early morning in the radio to a CEO of a company, an entrepreneur. Yeah. I'm not a sports entrepreneur. And next month, I'm going to be unveiled by Mission 89 as an ambassador. So I wanted to wear the cap and let it fit very well. All of that said, thank you very much, everybody. And I will hook up.
You wanted to present a more sober image.
Yeah. COVID-19 took my dreadlocks. All right, guys. Bye. Good night.
Thank you.
Ciao. Bye.